I'm a researcher at the Solid Mechanics Laboratory in École Polytechnique, and I'm going to present a fast simulation of grain growth based on orientated tessellation updating method. So I'm going to detail what it is. And the idea is to focus only on grain coarsening after recrystallization. So I focus only on surface energy at the grain boundaries. And the general idea of the work is to develop a macroscopic model. I come from a macroscopic world. I do solid mechanics, continuum mechanics. So my most important interest is in macroscopic models. So my idea was to deal with this by developing some approach to follow the microstructure for large parts, very large parts. The idea is to optimize the process, forming processes or fabrication processes, to control the temperature to obtain some targeted microstructure at large scales. So the idea of this macroscopic model is not to develop a phenomenological approach or empirical approach, but to develop some energetic upscaling strategy from lower scales. So at each material point of the macroscopic model, I develop some state variables that are the statistical descriptor of the microstructure. So I do not detail the microstructure very clearly, but I only carry the statistical description of this microstructure at the microscale. So for instance, the disorientation distribution at each material point, I can have the mean and the standard deviation of such distribution, or the shape and size distribution of the microscopy. The energetic upscaling strategy is related to keeping the energetic contribution at different scales. So of course, I'm going to reduce, to limit the validity of the model to have a manageable macroscopic model in the end. So to do that, I need a toy model at the scale of the polycrystal in order to make a lot of computation to create a database to feed the macroscopic model in the end. So I need very fast modeling at the scale of the polycrystal of grain growth. And by doing this, I will use this database to create a thermodynamic approach at the macro scale. Je parle trop fort. So I'm going to show you just the few scales I'm going to consider. So at the atomic scale, I will consider some crystal arrangement. What I call the microscopic scale is the scale of the grain boundary. So we have some crystal disorientation at the grain boundary. So we have a surface energy here. What I call the mesoscopic scale is the scale of the polycrystal. And the macroscopic scale is the continuum scale with the statistical description of the polycrystal. Today, I'm going to show you what I've done only for the first three scales. I won't detail the macroscopic model because it's not completely finished. But I'm going to show you the first upscaling method. So the idea is that I only consider the curvature-driven grain growth, which is written here, with the surface energy of the grain boundary here and the radius of curvature. And there are many approaches to deal with this. Most of the approaches, since this speed is dealing with the grain boundary, is to describe somehow the grain boundary, the curvature of the grain boundary in detail. And this may be computationally costly, so I cannot perform a very large database probing the space of all possible microstructures. So I'm going to develop a very simple one, what I call a toy model. And one of the most important assumptions is I deal only with 2D polycrystals, so it's a plain hexagonal polycrystal. All the crystals are, for instance, it's an FCC-oriented 1-1-1 direction. And so we have in this plane an hexagonal arrangement. There is no bulk energy. There is no densities of dislocation, for instance. And I'm going to develop what I call the orientated tessellation updating method. So the idea is when you see a movie of grain growth, you have several pictures of different microstructures. And for each picture, you can just approximate the macrostructure by a Voronoi tessellation, for instance. And if you do that for all the pictures, you have an evolution of the Voronoi tessellation. And the idea is to update the Voronoi tessellation parameters to follow the microstructure. So what is a Voronoi tessellation? Of course, you know that. You have seeds, so you have coordinates, and you have also weights, and you create the cells by just a simple rule. And you also add the crystal orientation. So in 2D, I only have one angle to deal with this. And finally, the set of the parameters describing the tessellation is coordinates, weights, and angles. And I'm going to update not all of these parameters, but only the weights, just to make things simpler, because I really need to have a simple macroscopic model in the end to see if it works or not. So at the atomic scale, I choose an interatomic potential. So this is a Minshin 2006 for pure iron. And I just performed a molecular dynamics computation in a symmetric tilt 111. So I do not deal with the grain boundary plane in this work, because it was too complicated to create state variables at the macroscopic scale. So, and I interpolate the results with the Wolf interpolation. So this computation have been done at zero Kelvin. So to have the surface energy at any temperature, I just scale the molecular dynamics computation with the shear modulus here. And this interpolation looks very like to the Reed and Shockley equation. So now I have the surface energy, which is the driving force in my system. I need a resistive part, because if there is no resistive part, the grain just grow as fast as it can. So the resistive part is the dissipation when the grain boundary move at some speed. So I need to compute the dissipated power when the grain boundary moves at some speed. And the dissipative mechanism is just crystal plasticity. When the grain boundary moves, I need to transform this crystal into the blue one, into the first one. So I need to just activate some slip system to make the crystallographic turn. And this computation has been done by hand analytically in 1999 by Brocato and Erlacher and Tamani. And they obtain a very simple dissipated power as a function of the crystal disorientation and the speed of the grain boundary. So here you have the analytic function. It's very simple. But this is for crystal plasticity. And we know that the grain growth is more viscous. So I transform this shear stress. This is the critical shear stress when the slip system is activated. And I transform this into something proportional to the speed. So I will end with something which is viscous. And here, the proportionality factor is homogeneous to grain mobility. So for me, it's a grain mobility now. And finally, the dissipated power, seen as a viscous phenomena, is something analytical divided by mobility and quadratic in the speed of the grain boundary. So here is the method. We just start with some Voronoi tessellation. So I use the Neper developed by Romanquet. And I affect some crystal orientation in it. And then I need to know the length of each grain boundaries. The crystal orientation, I can infer the crystal misorientation between two grains. And this is on a completely dimensionless. And the only dimension, physical dimension, is the length of the square of the tessellation. So this is the only real physical length. So now at the mesoscale, I just detail what are the two ingredients at the microscale. Now I show the method at the mesoscale. So at the mesoscale, I just compute the total energy and the total dissipated power for any grain boundary migration in the polycrystal. So the total energy is, of course, the sum of all the surface energy multiplied by their length, multiplied by the physical length. And the total dissipation for any speed is the sum of all the dissipation relative to respect to their own speed. And this, there is a problem in it, because as you see, we need to control the speed of the grain boundaries. And I do not control the speed of the grain boundaries, because I only control the weights. And when you activate one weight, you make several grain boundaries at each time. So you need a relationship between the speed of the grain boundaries and the weights. And this relationship is linear because the Voronoi tessellation definition is very simple, so you can make analytic computation, and there is a linear relationship between the weights and the speed of the grain boundaries. But it's not a one-by-one relationship. As you see, there is a tensor here. And so I can transform all the speed here into weights. And I obtain this dissipated power for any virtual weight variation in the tessellation. And this is only a dimensionless tensor, which completely depends on the tessellation parameters. So now I have the two ingredients, energy and dissipation. I need some evolution law, and of course I will try with first and second law of thermodynamics, and I give the balance equation here. So this balance equation, when you just plug this into this, you obtain this relation. This is a constraint. The evolution law should verify this balance equation. And now the evolution law, what it is I just maximize the dissipation in the system. If I maximize the dissipation in the system, I will have the strongest decrease of the energy in the end because of the evolution law, because of the balance equation. So I maximize the dissipation under the constraint of the evolution law. And you can do this by hand. It's quite straightforward. And you obtain the evolution law. That means the variation of the weights here as a function of the surface energy at zero Kelvin and the variation of the length when you vary the weights. And this gradient here is computed analytically because of the very definition of the orientated tessellation. So here you see that all the temperature dependence are here. And this is a tensor that only depends, it's dimensionless, it only depends on the orientated tessellation parameters. And here you see there is a size effect. The L naught, the only physical length in the system, is here. So that means that the speed of evolution will depend on the real size of the grains. If you take two exact similar tessellation, depending on the size you affect, the physical size of the grains, it will affect the speed of the growth. So now we need to calibrate. I forgot to mention these techniques. Have already been developed in the past, this updating tessellation method. And the main difference is that I use an energetic framework to deal with the growth. Because usually they use the curvature-driven growth. But as I said, you do not control the speed of the grain boundaries, and there is no curvature in the Voronoi tessellation. So I feel that the energetic framework is more convenient for such an approach. Now, how do you calibrate the mobility? In the dissipation, I introduce a mobility, but I'm not sure it's the same as the mobility we define for the curvature-driven evolution. So I compare two similar situations. This is the typical grain shrinkage for curvature-driven mobility here. And this is a similar approximation. It's an approximation of the circular grain. And this, you can do the computation completely by hand. It's very simple. And you obtain this relationship between the curvature-driven mobility that is here in the curvature-driven evolution law and the mobility I introduced in my model. And you see it's not equal. There is a function that should be taken into account. This function arises in the dissipation because of the plastic slip system. But if you measure this one at some crystallographic disorientation, you can infer a value for the mobility in the model. So here is some results. So you start with some Voronoi tessellation with orientation. So since it's a plane hexagonal, the orientation are going from 0 to 60 degrees because it's periodic every 60 degrees. And you start with this and you just let the time go. The mobility here has been calibrated with pure iron in the work of Sinclair and Bréchet, I think. So it depends on temperature also. And you see the growth. And this, you can compute this very, very quickly. Here, the main computation, the most computationally cost, the computational cost is mostly due to the way I compute, I program that. I use Nepair, and Nepair create a tech files, and then I read the tech file to update. And so, if we plug the code directly in as a module of Nepair, it will go much faster than the actual computation time. Here is some results at seven. The temperature is a bit lower, so you see that it doesn't evolve because the mobility is too low. So that means the dissipation is very high because it's 1/mobility in the dissipation. That means the cost of by means of dissipation is too high when the temperature is too low. So it doesn't evolve because even if the system would have the driving force, the dissipation is so high that it's not efficient for the energetic content. So here is some other examples. And now I'm just focused on some improvements because I simplified a lot the validity of the model because I just remove everything. I just keep the core of the system, which is the curvature-driven growth. So the first improvement is, of course, going to 3D. In this step, I just avoid to go to 3D initially because I didn't want to have too many state variables at the macroscopic scale. But now I know it's working in 2D. It's not so bad to go to 3D for the mesoscopic model because Voronoi tessellation really works very well in 3D. And updating the weights in 3D or in 2D is exactly the same thing, actually. I could add also energy attached to the triple points that I completely neglect here. Of course, I need to introduce some bulk energy, like density of dislocation in each grain, for instance, which is also completely neglected here. And we can also, instead of just updating the weights of the tessellation, we can also update the seeds, the position of the seeds, to deform the grains more. Of course, I also neglected the rotation of crystal orientation. For instance, for very, very small grains, maybe it's more efficient to just turn the grain instead of growing. And to turn the grain, you need to calculate the activated slip system to just turn the grain. So this can be done by hand also and introduced in the computation as a dissipation mechanism also. Okay, I'm going to just make a short summary of all the ideas. I start at the atomic scale by choosing an interatomic potential. I perform molecular dynamics to infer at the micro scale the grain boundary energy as a function of disorientation. And I also compute a resistive mechanism, which is the dissipated power through any virtual grain boundary speed. And at the mesoscale, I just sum all the energies. And then I obtain a model at the mesoscale that is connected only with the energy contribution from scale to scale. And at the macro scale, so this step I didn't detail today, but you lose the deterministic approach. The model I presented is completely deterministic, but since you need to reduce the quantity of information you have, you deal only with a distribution of statistic of crystallographic disorientation, for instance, you lose the details, and so two exact same macroscopic microstructure are very different at the mesoscale and may evolve differently. So you have a probabilistic approach at the macroscale because the macroscopic scale erases too much detail, and so it's a probabilistic way of evolving in the end. So thank you very much. I hope it was clear. Yeah.